Welcome to Now Church. We are about to begin. Please take this opportunity to pull out your smartphone so you can like, share, and check in on our social media platforms, including Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And please use the hashtag NowChurch. Thank you, and enjoy today's service.
We give you all the glory.
Church, you become the church. But the church isn't the building. The church is the vision. The church is the people. The church is the gathering. It doesn't matter if we have stained glass or not. We're not looking for religious symbolism. We're looking for spiritual substance that's found only in Christ Jesus. The substance is that we're giving a place for a gathering for His presence to come and connect with real people with real problems and situations on a real journey that just have a sincere heart to move along and get to know God better. That's what church life is about. We are Now Church, building a relevant, creative church, empowering people to reach others. Not just empowered for yourself, but empowered to go love somebody that was unlovable. Come onto this property, into this auditorium, and have experienced a life-changing touch from God. But we believe that our best days are still ahead of us, not behind us. In order to keep doing that, though, you can't rest on what you've accomplished. Why are we still looking for the best days? Because we're not enthralled with our past as much as we are captivated by our future. Now Church has never been stronger, more focused, more united around our common mission, vision, and values. By God's grace, we are healthy, and we're poised for the future.
Good morning, Church. I'm going to say it again. Good morning, church. I wonder if you could do me a favor and throw your hands up. I see them clapping. I'm going to put them up high in the air this morning and just say, Jesus, you are welcome here. And we thank you for all that you've done, all that you're doing, and all that we trust you're going to do. I worship you because of who you are. I give you the glory that you deserve. If you could now, just go ahead and give Him praise in the house. Come on. Come on, give Him praise in the house. We love you, Jesus. We love you, Lord. Woo!
Our Father,
anybody believe in miracles? Say.
Right now, in the name of Jesus,
and freedom
future, crushing all doubt and fear, right here.
In the name of Jesus.
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 Oh, there's no name higher than his name. So this morning, I wonder if you could, for a few moments, just close your eyes. I was telling the team, and even in the huddle this morning, it's so interesting because we get a chance time after time to come in and encounter his presence, and sometimes stuff isn't, you know, the perfect on the natural. But we serve a God who is faithful, and all he wants to be is pursued. So we pursue you this morning. One more time, all over the building, throw those hands up in the air and just say it again. But you don't have to repeat after me. You just say what comes to your heart. Come on, let your voices, let your mouths begin to give him thanks. Begin to audibly pursue him today. We pursue you, Jesus. And we thank you that your presence is right where two or three are gathered together. And we thank you that in your name there are miracles, signs, wonders, healing. Mountains move. Lives change. Emotions are healed. Our bodies are healed. You're a faithful God. We love you, Jesus. Come on, lift your voices. Lift your worship now. We worship you, Jesus. Come on, I'm not moving on. Tell me. Let his spirit fill this place. Yeah. And again, and again, and again, and again, I will rejoice. And again I will worship you. And again I will lift my voice. And again I'm reminded of how faithful you are. Oh, Jesus. Yeah. Thank you, Lord. This is a house of worship. This is a place of praise, where every demon trembles, where we proclaim your name. This is a house of our hearts are full of faith. You have our full attention, God. You have the final say. So pray this prayer with this church. We say, come alive in the name of Jesus. Come on.
Come alive in the name of Jesus.
Resurrection
power. Your
I still believe your move. I still believe your speak. God, I believe your word. All things for good. Sing it out. I fix my family this week, and you love Jesus and you take your atmosphere where you go. I just want to drink in your presence for just a moment, just a moment, just a moment. I still believe you're faithful, God. God of the impossible is who we serve today. Yeah. Last time. Because I still believe your move. Say it. I still believe.
As we're worshiping God, we're coming to the strength of unity. Let's be the church. Because in the midst of the worship, we're elevated. We come into the presence of God in a powerful way. But we still have quite a calling to affect our nation. Amen? And one of the most powerful ways we can do this is when we are shifting in that worship time into a prayer time. Causing a time where we've received the presence of God, and now we're interceding for the presence of God for our nation. And one of the things that we were just talking about earlier this weekend, we were just seeing some pastor was bringing up some things that he had heard and researched online and found out some of the stats. But there was something, a news agency that put out, and several of them, all of them agreed with what was going on. There was, since January 1, there were an incident, 600 incidences of what they call mass shootings in the United States since January 1. And that's based on four people other than the shooter, you know, in each incident, 600 times. And so I looked up, when Pastor Richard brought it up, I literally said that, I mean, it's just no way. That's shocking. No way. And then when I looked it up, then I found that what's happened, that's been 3 years in a row that it's been over 600 per year. And so what that speaks of, it's not just the exterior things, but the heart of it is, it's a spirit, a heart condition of our nation that is the real issue. And there's so many levels of this, but when a nation... even in, you know, whatever it may be, in policies or mindsets, has kind of pushed God to the peripheral, off to the side. And we're not allowing him to be in his presence, to be in everything that we're doing. You know what happens is people's hearts grow hard, grow callous. and they start even just missing out on the value of life, right? So we want to pray right now and turn our praise into prayer and pray for our nation that they would know the presence of God that we feel right now. Amen? So just let's agree right now for our nation. Father, thank you, Lord, for your mercy. First, we call on your mercy. You said if your church would humble itself and pray and seek your face and turn from any wicked ways, that you would hear from heaven, that you would heal our land. And Lord, we as your church, we stand in the gap for a nation that's drifting. And Lord, we pray for your mercy. Lord, we do humble ourselves and we ask you, Lord, that you would be God like you are right now to us in this moment. Lord, reveal yourself. Soften hard hearts. Grant them the gift of repentance, those that are far from you and warring against you and attitudes and thoughts and trying to war to have their own way. Father, we pray for your mercy that they would not have their own way for their good, Lord. That you would reveal yourself. Lord, we welcome you into our homes. We welcome you into our families. We welcome you into our governments, and we welcome you into our schools. We welcome you into our workplaces. We welcome you into our entertainment systems. We welcome you into our sports. We welcome you into our culture, Lord. Find your place to be Lord Jesus God over our nation. And Father, warm those hard hearts. Lord, give us, Lord, soft hearts for hard hearts, and turn our nation back to you, Lord. In Jesus' name, we give you praise. Amen. Come on, let's give him praise. That's how we get peace, his presence. Amen. That is awesome. Listen, we know, go ahead and lift up the lights there. We know, hopefully, you've had an incredible, good Thanksgiving time with your family. I don't know if it shows and there's evidence, but I want you to turn right now to everyone around you and just welcome them to Stretchy Pants Sunday. And we're going to continue on in a minute.
I can't get over what you've done for me. You got me saying like, amen.
That's great. You guys look fulfilled. I'll just put it that way, right? Do you feel fulfilled? Some of you still having those, like, you know, turkey omelets, turkey sandwiches, turkey, and, you know, whatever else that you're going to have. It's awesome. So anyway, so we're just celebrating, and this time we're just really excited at Now Church. We love every season, but we really love holiday season. It's amazing. We're moving quickly towards Christmas now, and we've got a lot of stuff planned at Now Church. And one of the things we wanted to tell you about is an outreach. We're going to be partnering with Pay It Forward Ministries, and we're going to be doing an outreach to help. Our plan is, the vision, the target, is to help 100 families with children in need. We're going to bless them and help them for Christmas. Is that good? We want to make sure that kids have a really good Christmas and know that someone loves them. Now Church loves them. Pay It Forward loves them. Jesus loves them. And we want to make sure that they celebrate. So we have some other details we're going to give you at the end of service. That's why we have the tables out. We'll explain that at the end of service. But you don't want to miss this right at the end. You'll get a chance for us to just show our generosity. You guys always, with these outreaches, you always bless people's socks off. Let me just tell you that. And let me tell you, first service, you always, you know, you always get most of the sponsors. And second service comes in, they're like, where's all the stuff? We wanted to sponsor too. So I'm just saying, we are in a great, generous church, and that's the place to be, all right? So thinking of that, we want to welcome you to Now Church. Listen, we're excited that you're here. If this is your first experience with Now Church, we always want to make sure that you've come in and you've felt the hospitality, that you are welcome here. We're glad you're here. Make sure you go by our Welcome Center. We have some gifts for you. It's not even Christmas, and we're giving away gifts. But anyway, so we're blessing you for coming. And also, we challenge you with a three-week challenge. Let's check out Now Church 3 weeks in a row and see what God does. Look, this is a great time to give God his focus time and see what he does and how he operates and moves in your life in powerful ways. All right? So right now, I want you to give it up for our senior pastor stepping up here, Pastor Richard. He's got a great word today.
I hope you're right. You always say that by faith, but I don't know. I've got a great word. I do know, but he doesn't know. Anyway, it's going to be great. We're finishing our series on faith that moves mountains. And I want you to recognize that more things can happen with your faith than anything else. I mean, there's so much doubt in the world. There's so much fear. But the people of faith need to rise up in that faith, right? Today we finish with a message I call Victory Has a Voice. Victory Has a Voice, starting with Psalm 47 and working into Zechariah 4. Psalm 47, verse 1 and 2 says this, "Oh, clap your hands, all you peoples. Shout to God with the voice of triumph. For the Lord Most High is awesome. He's a great king over all the earth." And then verse 5 says this, "God has gone up with a shout, the Lord with the sound of a trumpet." I'm just going to pause there for a moment, because I love words. I love word studies. I love to kind of dig into the wealth of the Bible. And this week I was drilling down into just this passage just for my devotions, and all of a sudden just came alive in my spirit. How many know that when you clap, it's usually not golf clap? Golf clap, you know what golf clap is? That's what everybody, he steps up for the putt. It's a three-footer. And he makes it. Here's a slow golf clap. Clapping has some sound to it. And then it says, shout unto God with a voice of triumph. And I was amazed, because the Hebrew word for shout there is the word ruah. It means war cry. To split the ears with sound or make a signal for battle. Signal God that it's time to fight for his people. And when it says, and God has gone up with a shout, verse 5, the word there is alal in the Hebrew. It says God is exalted, stirred up, and roused in strength for action by the shouting of his people, by the war cry of his people. My friends, you and I have a great responsibility. When we clap our hands, it's not just, okay, we're at church, isn't this nice? We're signaling God. We need him to arise and fight for us. Amen. And then it says in Zechariah chapter 4, verse 6, "So he answered and said to me in this vision, this is the word of the Lord to Zerubbabel." I'll explain more in a few moments. "Not by might, nor by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord of hosts. Who are you, O great mountain? Before Zerubbabel, you shall become a plain, and he shall bring forth the capstone with shouts of grace, grace to it." Let's pray one more time. Father, open the eyes of our heart, we pray today. We're here to pursue you, as Pastor Lindsey said. We're here to seek you, to chase after you, to run after you, to pull on you, to prevail upon you, to let you know we desire you, we're desperate for you, and we need you, and we love you. Come, Holy Spirit, open the eyes of our hearts to understand today that faith comes by understanding, and understanding by the words of your book. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, faith that moves mountains is so much more powerful than human emotion. A lot of times we live in a culture, and even in the church world much of the time, we've been conditioned to believe that our feelings are the trump card. Our feelings are the main thing, that if you feel it, it's real. And yet the Word of God says that faith is more real than what you feel. It'd be a good song. Pastor Lindsey, it'd be a good song. Faith more real than what you feel. We talked last week about Jairus. And if he was led by natural human emotions, he could have run ahead of God and gotten to the place where his miracle that he needed wouldn't have happened yet. And it just reminded us that faith moves in a walk with Jesus. We've been talking this whole month about our need to continually grow in faith. It has to be nurtured, it has to be strengthened, it has to be developed. And so this month has been kind of a, hopefully a faith checkup for you. It's been a faith checkup for me. And I want to say this at the outset today. Faith grows when there's a demand placed on it. Faith doesn't grow in a vacuum. Faith doesn't grow in nothingness. Faith grows when you're in a situation where God needs to rise up, where God needs to fight for you, where God needs to be stirred into action to answer your prayers. And so what happens is there are moments we talk about, you know, we talk about this, but you have to understand it. When you're going through something, it's an opportunity to put a smile on God's face, because without faith, it's impossible to please him. But he that comes to God must believe that he is God and that he is a rewarder, that he will answer you when you seek him diligently. There's a diligence to faith. And the problem is, in our culture today, even among the Christian culture of America, a lot of our faith is very passive. It's very, whatever will be. It's very que sera, sera. It's very, three people know Doris Day, but anyway, it's an understanding that when you're in a place where you have to see God move, it's uncomfortable, but that's where your faith is growing. So when you say, God, build my faith, help me to grow in faith, you're not asking for calamity, but you're saying, God, I love you more than this uncomfortableness that I feel sometimes when my faith is stretched. And so I want you to stretch my faith, grow my faith, help me to grow in that faith. We often talk about grace and faith working together. You know, you're not saved, for you're saved by grace through faith, that not of yourselves, it's the gift of God, lest any man should boast. Ephesians chapter 2, right? So grace and faith work together. I mentioned a couple of times this month. But I've been kind of meditating this week on what amazing grace really means when it's connected to faith. You know, grace theologically means that everything good, including the faith to believe and trust God in the first place, emanates from God himself. That grace means that everything comes from God, even faith. Even the unctions of the anointing and the tremendous presence of the Holy Spirit, everything originates with God, not with us. We use the acronym God's riches at Christ's expense, or God's righteousness at Christ's expense, or God's redemption at Christ's expense. It's all at Jesus' expense. It all costs God more than it costs you or me. Grace means that we don't get the punishment we deserve, but we do get what we don't deserve, which is mercy, favor, and empowerment because of the sacrifice of Jesus. Grace means we don't get the wrath of God in eternal hell for our own sins, but the blessings of his perfection. Grace means that we receive the blessings and the power of the Holy Spirit. Grace means that God turns every minus into a plus. In fact, Paul the Apostle is talking about having these tremendous visions of God, and yet he has these challenges in his own life that he talks about, the thorn in the flesh. And he says, three times I sought God, just take away this thorn, just do a quick miracle, do a quick work. And what was the answer? Jesus spoke to him and said, my grace is sufficient for you. My grace is enough and more than enough. Listen, for my strength is matured or perfected in your weakness. Man, I hate weakness. I hate my own weakness. I hate it. You know, I'm reminded during the holidays of how little willpower I actually have. I mean, I was completely full of Thanksgiving meal on Thursday, as most people were. I mean, completely full. And then the dessert came. And I found room. And then I didn't need more dessert. But somehow the dessert called to me again as I passed by. My son found, you know, one of our old favorites back from when we had a village inn in Ocala, which is over 30 years ago now, was French silk pie. So our son was in Tampa or someplace last week, passed by a village inn and said, "Oh, I can bring home French silk pie for Thanksgiving." In fact, he brought home two. He brought one for last weekend and one to put away for Thanksgiving. So I've had about four pieces of French soaked pie in the past week. And then my pants were tight this morning. Like Pastor Chris said, it's stretchy pants time. Stretchy, what do you call it? Stretchy pants day. Huh? Stretchy pants Sunday. I love that. Weakness dissolved by his grace. Zechariah gives us a different side of moving the mountains in our lives. I'd never seen the parallel between what we preached a few weeks ago in Mark the 10th chapter. You know, you shall, whosoever shall speak to this mountain with faith in his heart, nothing doubting, shall have what he says, the mountain shall be removed. I never saw that as a parallel passage to Zechariah chapter 4 until this week. Zechariah talks about moving the mountains, but he also tells us how to do it, how to speak to our mountains. He tells us what the Lord would have us to speak and reminds us that the pressure is not on us. We can't move mountains, but he can. A couple of our crew techie guys today are running around with their "Nothing is Impossible with Jesus" t-shirts from a couple years ago. It's probably my favorite t-shirt we've ever done. I love that. Love that. It's from a graphic that Ryan did a couple years ago, or a year and a half ago now, and it has three mountains on the top. Nothing is impossible with Jesus. And Jesus said, nothing is impossible with him that believes. The pressure's not on us to move the mountain. Our role is to prophesy to the mountain. And moving that mountain is actually not by might, not by power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord. It is the work of the Holy Spirit. Grace is the work of the Holy Spirit. The moving of the mountain is the work of the Holy Spirit, and we need him more than we ever have. So what do you say to the obstacles in your way? Zechariah says, you prophesy to them. You prophesy. What is to prophesy? To prophesy doesn't mean, thus said the Lord God. Some fancy thing where you sweat and dab your hanky. Prophesies is simply say what God is saying. To declare what God is saying in a certain situation. What do you say to the obstacles in your way? What do you say to the delays you experience in your life? What do you say when it's not going your way? You prophesy to the mountain. The word of the Lord came to Zechariah that Zerubbabel, for those of you who don't know your Bible history, was the grandson of King Jehoiachin. Jehoiachin, and Jehoiachin was the one that was carried away captive with his family to Babylon. And the Bible says that Zerubbabel, the grandson of King Jehoiachin, easy for me to say, would help lead the exiles of Israel back from captivity into Zion. He said, Zechariah says this, before Zerubbabel, the mountain will be flattened. It won't just be removed like move from here to there. It will be flattened. It'll be reduced to a plain. You ever heard somebody say, that person's making a mountain out of a molehill. Our God takes a mountain and makes it the size of a molehill. He flattens the mountains in our way by the Spirit of the Lord. Now the word Zerubbabel, and this is another interesting little study here. Zerubbabel means sown in Babylon. A seed sown in Babylon. Zerubbabel. Babylon is in his name. Here's the grandson of the king, the last king of Israel before captivity. And Zechariah steps up and says, Zerubbabel, what was sown in Babylon? In other words, good things will still arise out of your trouble and give you the power to conquer by grace, by God's grace. Even, you're being real quiet today. I think some of you are still in tryptophan. All that turkey stuff that Pastor Chris mentioned, and you're a little sleepy. I want you to track with me here. You got to get this. Now remember, all I am is the fountain, okay? A pastor brings the word. The word is sacred. The pastor is flawed, human. I'm a fountain. Those who get the best drink are those who pull the hardest and the strongest. And so pulling is simply responding. That's why we don't like yes and amen because we're looking for flattery or noise in the church. We look for yes and amen of agreement when you actually get it. When you understand it, you need to say, amen. So be it according to what you just said. Yes. Go after it. Pull on the word of the Lord and you'll get more. Zerubbabel means sown in Babylon. Did we have that on the screen? Did we not have that on the screen? Sown in Babylon. Not S-E-W-N like sown with a sewing machine. A seed. In a foreign land, when everything else looks like you've blown it and God has left you alone. That's grace. This is a seed. So Zerubbabel, hey Zerubbabel, you might have been sown in Babylon. You might be a seed sown in Babylon. But let me tell you something. You are going to rise up and you are going to be given power to conquer because you're the seed of God. And what do we prophesy? What does he say? As Zerubbabel, you shall speak to the mountain. What does he say? You shall shout, Ruach, war cry, grace, grace. Get so under works righteousness sometimes. Even faith people. In fact, I'll say it this way, especially faith people. Because we take so much on ourselves. We are responsible to pray for our nation. But we're not responsible for the murders in our nation. We're responsible spiritually to pray, to intercede for those things. And that's an awesome weight sometimes, isn't it? But sometimes we take that weight on ourselves. So at the end of the day, I love what Peter writes. He said, casting all your care upon him, for he cares for you. There's a place where you have to pray, and there's a place where you have to release it. And part of being a strong intercessor, as we are in this church, we're an intercessory prayer church. Just in case you don't know that, we're an intercessory prayer church. And because we're an intercessory prayer church, we have to know when to pray and when to trust God and recognize it's not, we have the burden, then we release the burden, and then we relax, because it's God's burden. His yoke is easy, his burden is light, right? Sometimes you have to shout to your obstacles. Hey, mountain, my awesome God is about to come on the scene and blow you up. Okay? That's the prophecy. That's what this word is. Grace, grace is saying, hey, mountain, hey, obstacle. My awesome God is about to come on the scene and blow you away. I don't know when. I don't know how he's going to do it, but Jesus is Lord of this. Jesus is Lord of this. You got bad news this week? From a doctor or a lawyer or a banker? Jesus is Lord of this. Or as young David said to the giant, you have defied the armies of the living God, and he will give me your head today. He will give me your head today. He will give me your head today. He will move this obstacle today. I trust my God. David prophesied to the giant, and you have to prophesy to your mountain too. Now here's good news. If you don't hear anything I say today, write this down right now, because this is the word of the Lord. Triumph is voice activated. We live in a time where we speak to Siri, or we speak to Google, or we speak to Alexa to have the lights on, or the, you know, call so-and-so, or do this or do that. Our God is on the scene with your war cry, with your shout of faith, with your shout of praise, even when you don't feel it, especially when you don't feel it. Victory, triumph is voice activated. God has affirmed this in his word since Genesis 1, where God said, light be, and light was. Way before Alexa could turn on the lights, God turned them on with his voice and then created man in his image and says, here, do what I do. Say what I say. Do what I'm saying to do. God spoke it into existence and the worlds were framed. Your world is being framed by your words. Activate your voice. Activate your faith. How many times do you hear somebody say, oh man, that's killing me? You know, it's just different things that we say in the culture. Guilty of it myself, and I'm not trying to get you to be the word police, okay? A lot of faith churches are filled with the word police. That people will rebuke you for what you said wrong. No, no, I'm trying to say for yourself. Listen to yourself sometimes. Listen to yourself in how we're conditioned downward, not upward, that we say dumb things. But and listen, it's not just saying the words that activate it. It's the belief in what you say is activated. So you don't really believe that your finger is killing you when you hurt your finger. But it also is not agreeing with what God said. By his stripes you are healed. You were healed 2,000 years ago. Another definition of grace, and we'll finish up the month on this. Grace is the unmerited favor of God. The unmerited favor of God. This is another area where grace meets faith. You see, you have to use your faith to access God's favor. That's grace. I've learned this time and time again as I've traveled the world for the last many years, many decades. You access goodwill by faith. Even in the traveling part, I can't tell you how many times I've been on sold-out airplanes. Even people waiting for a seat on standby. And yet the seat directly next to me is open and stays open because God cares for me. That's not every time, because God wants you to be humble too. But God cares for your comfort. God's favor means you live an exceptional life. An exceptional life. You're the odds breaker. If it's one in a million, you're telling me there's a chance, right? Anyway, at least a few more people remember Dumb and Dumber. Best movie in history. We quote, in our family, we quote Dumb and Dumber probably once a week. In other words, for you to live an exceptional life, it means when the odds are against you, God is still for you. Now, I want to say this. I want to qualify by saying this. Moral principles and laws do apply to you. But the normal course of the way things work does not. When I say moral principles and laws do apply, means this. If you want to walk in favor, you have to walk in kindness and humility as you walk in favor. Those things go hand in hand, because otherwise an entitlement mentality comes, and the moment you get an entitlement mentality, it stops the whole flow. like football teams. Listen, I've been a lifelong Gator fan since I'm 15 years old, and I've lived in the highs and I've lived in the lows, and the lows are no fun. But here's the problem. In the high moments, our fan base developed an entitlement mentality, and we don't show up unless you perform. And we don't show up because now it's uncomfortable because we don't know if we're going to win right. It was a lot more fun when we knew we were going to win, or we knew it was going to be a battle, or we knew we had a winning coach or a winning season. And it's the same thing. Listen, I've been around, I love Nancy Blackman. Nancy Blackman is the world's largest or biggest fan for Ohio State University. She's a big fan. There says we got another person right here. Ushers? No. No, I respect them. But when the Gators played the national championship 2006 game, my son and I went to Glendale, Arizona, and we were at the game, and it was probably, I don't know, 5-1 ratio of Ohio State fans versus Gator fans. And the Ohio State fans came in with this attitude like they shouldn't even have to play this game. They should already be crowned because we were just a formality. And I remember sitting there thinking, well, that's kind of smug. I hope we never get to be like that, which we did. And right in front of us, this mother and daughter were sitting there, and the daughter was probably 18, 20 years old. The mom was probably in her 40s. And they were obnoxious Ohio State fans. I mean, obnoxious. And they were, and so we were in an area where it was mostly Gator fans, but then all of a sudden all the Ohio State fans were all in front of us, and we were kind of the dividing line. And these women, on the first play of the game, Ted Ginn Jr., well, I don't want to describe football here today, but some of you are going to sleep. So anyway, on the first play of the game, the guy receives the kickoff in the end zone, runs it back 100 yards, scores a touchdown for Ohio State. And these ladies turned and went, and they were jumping up and down, screaming, doing, they were trying to spell Ohio. They got mixed up. It was kind of crazy. Anyway. So they were like gloating, and I just said, it's a long game. Relax. And the Gators won 41-14 over Ohio State. Nancy. Sorry. No, the point is, entitlement is always a danger. Because entitlement is connected to pride. And pride goes before destruction, not a fall. See, the world says pride goes before a fall. That's not what the Bible says. The Bible says pride goes before destruction, a haughty spirit before a fall. Pride goes before destruction, haughty spirit before a fall. Humble yourself and say, Lord, he'll lift you up. So I enjoy the favor of God, but I try never to place a demand on people or an expectation on them because I'm anything, because I'm nothing. The first time I got upgraded to first class on an international flight, this is probably over 20 years ago, I was put on an international flight from Copenhagen to Atlanta with Delta, and I'd got enough points where they had moved me up already. Well, then this is when they used to have something called first class, and there's like four seats. And this is first class, this is elite first class. They brought everything out on fine china. And they brought me, tell me you know this story, but they brought me caviar. And I was like, golly, I'm from Ocala. I was embarrassed But I was not too embarrassed to say to the flight attendant, I don't know how to eat this. And I don't know if I'm going to like it. She said, okay. I love when people sit up here that don't. She said, let me teach you caviar. So she took the caviar. She put on this fancy thing of bread. She squeezed a little lemon juice over it, which I thought I would hate. And then she mixed it with sour cream, which I love. Now I'm up in first class on fine china, looking back at my other seat where I had been. And I'm eating caviar. For some reason, my pinky went up. When I did it, I just having a spot of tea. Bring me the head of a pig. You know, it was like, you know, I felt like a king. I felt like what? But I also felt so unworthy. I felt so undeserving. And a lot of times in my life, I've found that the greatest grace comes at the time when you're the most humble or the most down or the most uncomfortable, like, I don't know if I deserve this, because I don't. And God says, and now I want to bless you. Favor. My friend, favor is yours. You know, there's a whole thing, you know, years ago, I don't know if T.D. Jakes preached or whatever, people would say, blessed and highly favored. It was out of a quote about Mary receiving the Magnificat, that Jesus was going to be born in her. And she's talking about, you know, blessed, I received this blessing. And so we say blessed, and we used to joke about it, say blessed and highly flavored. But the favor of God is there. The favor of God is on you. It's accessible. You have to step into it by faith. But you don't do it with meanness or entitlement. You do it with a humble spirit. You do it with a gentleness. Favor works because the Holy Spirit is with you, on you, and for you. But people don't owe you. They don't owe you that. I've stayed in some of the best hotels in the world, and I've stayed in some of the conditions where you could not believe, and I didn't even want to lay my head on the pillow. I was in Managua, Nicaragua one time. The AC didn't work. The bathroom, everything was rusted. I didn't want to set my toiletry bag down on anything. And the sheets were dirty. And we had to keep the windows open because the AC wasn't working. And outside my window all night was a goat. I don't mean the greatest of all time. I mean a literal goat. And I would just get to sleep and I'd meh, meh. Oh, Lord, help me through this night. To go to sleep on that place, I literally took my clothes out and I put my T-shirts over the pillows and over the sheets. And I was so grossed out, I could hardly sleep. And I had to preach twice the next day. And I still did it with a humble spirit, a gentle spirit. No, I grumbled. I repent, I grumbled. The next day I did the best that I could. I preached the word with power. And then the next night we were not in a nice place. You just never know, but people don't owe you anything. The favor of God is on you, and you access it with an expectation, but not an entitlement. Okay? I'm almost done, but I want you to get this, because the favor that's on my life is on your life, not just for travel, but in every day. The journey of the children of Israel, they received God's favor to receive the provision they needed for the journey of the promised land. In preparing for the Passover miracle, Exodus chapter 11, verse 2, God said to Moses, speak now in the hearing of the people, and let every man ask from his neighbor and every woman from her neighbor articles of silver, articles of gold. This is while they're preparing to go into the house and put the blood over the doorpost. And the Lord, verse 3, and the Lord gave the people favor in the sight of the Egyptians. Do you know how hated, how despised the children of Israel were by the Egyptians? And yet they gave them because they asked, but they didn't ask like demanding. They asked, hey, God told us to ask. And people said, yes, leave. Please, just leave. Here's everything. Here's my silver. Here's my gold. Here's my clothing. Whatever you need, just go. God will give you favor even with that person at work that hates you. God will give you favor in that situation where they're speaking against you. God will give you favor with that professor, that teacher that just doesn't seem to like you because you're a Christian. Whatever it is, trust in the favor of God. These people were absolutely hated and despised, yet God showed up in his miracle favor. On your faith journey through life, God's divine favor puts you up even when other people pull you down. There are humbling moments, but you are against all the odds. There's favor in tough circumstances. Can't tell you how many times I've heard these words. I don't usually do this, and then something good happens for me. Or they say, I don't know why I'm doing this right now, but can't tell you how many times. That's not just in travel. That's just in my life. Someone say, well, we can't do this, but I'll make an exception for you. It's the favor of God. You give him praise. You trust in him. You do good. You stay sweet with people. The bottom line, you carry a spiritual atmosphere of either faith or doubt. Depends on what you're feeding into your heart and mind, not what you're feeling in your heart and mind. Feeding, not feeling. The word or the world. Carry God's goodness, carry God's grace and favor with dignity and respect for other people. Remember, victory always has a voice. Victory always has a voice. Glorify the Lord. Speak of his love and mercy. Declare his mighty power. Agree with his mighty word of truth. And never give up walking by faith and not by sight. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your holy word. We ask you to come and move in this place today. Lord, for every person that's watching online, hearing these words, we release and remind that anointing of God's favor. Great is your faithfulness, O God. We release that awareness of grace for this week. The things that happen for us are not because of us. The things that happen for us are because of Jesus. Jesus, King of kings and Lord of lords. I want to ask you a question today before we pray anymore, and that is this. What's your relationship with the Lord like right now? Don't tell me how close you used to be to God. Faith is a now thing. What's your relationship with the Lord like right now? Are you secretly holding feelings, resentment against God because you used your faith and it didn't happen like you wanted or in your timing? Repent. Repent today. The answer is repentance. The answer is to turn to God with all your heart and say, God, I don't want it to be like this. If you're not the closest to the Lord you've ever been, and if your faith is not the sharpest and strongest it's ever been, then you need to go to God today. And you need to get with God, maybe not in this room right now, but even when you get home, or this evening when you're about to go to sleep. He's worthy. His love is real and he loves you so much. Trust him. Maybe you're here today and you're not as close as you once were. Would you just say today, just say, Jesus, come into my life in a brand new way. I need a fresh anointing, a fresh start. I need new grace. Your mercies are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. I need that mercy. I need that grace today. And if you're going to get grace, the Bible says you got to give grace. Don't be impatient with everybody else's imperfections today. Trust him. Quit trying to be God to them. Just point to him. Love on him. Victory always has a voice. If you're going to shout, don't shout out of anger at humans. Go someplace alone and shout to God with a voice of victory. For your triumph, your victory is voice activated. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Did you get something today? I hope you enjoyed this one. I enjoyed studying it and preparing it. Anyway, before you go, we're going to receive our tithes and offerings. Also, remember the couples thing. Pastor Chris is going to tell you more, remind you more about that. But it's coming up next week already. This is couples date night. We're very excited. A good crowd is coming already, but there's room for you if you sign up today. For $30, it's a bargain. It's a steal to be able to have a nice date with your spouse. Or we have some dating couples want to come. That's great. We just are excited about this time to celebrate the holidays together and let it be a very sweet time. Also, some of you have been asking about we provide an opportunity. We wanted to bless the people that came for prayer a few weeks ago, and just say a big thank you to people that come for prayer. So we gave away tickets, and that event is going to be today at 3 o'clock. Isn't that right? 3 o'clock today. If you have a ticket, and only for you, we're going to be having what we're calling Legacy Building First Look. And so we're going to be meeting at 3 o'clock today, if you have a ticket in the new building, and bring a Sharpie if you have one, because we're going to be writing on the... We didn't do that. We can, before the drywall goes in, we found we can actually do some things with Sharpies on the skin, the inside skin of the building, and it'll be there forever. And so we're going to have that today, show the different rooms and put scriptures. If you prepare some scriptures ahead of time, be ready for that. 3 o'clock today, that's going to be really, really important. So we're going to have receive our tithes and offerings right now very quickly. You know, you can't live a faith-filled life walking in God's favor if you're a cheapskate. Thank you for that. Dennis said amen. Thank you, Dennis. Let me say it again. You can't live a faith-filled life walking in God's favor, free from entitlement, if you're a skinflint, miserly, cheapskate, wimpy. You know, every time God moves in revival in church history and in world history and in the Bible history, it's either preceded by, followed by, or accompanied by a great move of generosity. Like in the day of Pentecost, and then by Acts chapter 4, they were bringing their lands and their deeds to their houses and lands and laying them at the apostles' feet and giving. It was a supernatural thing. The church didn't require it. The people wanted to do it. Throughout the word of God, when God moved, I mean, under Moses one time, they had to restrain the people from giving because they brought too much. He said, no, cut it off. No more offerings. You brought too much. I'm longing for the day where we have to restrain you. No, please, we can't take anymore. It's great to be in a church with big vision, because God is looking for people to bless, to make the vision go forward, right? Thank you for your giving. Thank you for your generosity. But understand, you gotta move forward. Generosity is one of the greatest keys to unlock the victorious life that God has promised. People, a subtle deception of life is this. People say to themselves, well, if I had more, I'd give more. No, you wouldn't. Jesus said exactly what you're doing with the money you have right now is exactly the way you're gonna handle it if you got $10 million in your hands. Exactly the same. Anything else is a deception. Life works best when God is first. Today, Father, we put you first with our tithes and offerings. We know that they're holy and sacred to you, and we come with worship in our hearts. Would you come and move in this church community? Thank you for finishing the legacy building. Thank you for enabling us to bless the children in those households with so much need. We just ask you to bless us to be a blessing. And we thank you for pouring out your Spirit upon every gift and every giver. In Jesus' name, we speak multiplication. Amen. Amen. Thank you for your gift.
Here, but specifically for the couples night. Again, this is for married and dating couples, and also the registration's at the back. Pastor Richard didn't say, I'm not sure, but we're going to be going to the Marion Theater downtown, and so we're going to have a private showing of a movie just for us, which is pretty awesome, and having pizza as well too. But there is also childcare available. We need to know how many kids that you have and the ages. So when you go back to register, this is the table right there in the back. They're ready to help you. And guys, it's time to take our wives or your girlfriend out on a date. Wait, I need to clarify that. Guys that are married, take your wife out on a date. Guys that are not married, take your girlfriend out on a date. Okay, I just clarified. Okay, but make sure you go back there. Also, remember our special gathering, 3 o'clock today. I think Pastor Richard gave all the details for that as well, too. For those of you that were with us and you have your tickets when we came together for churchwide prayer, it's going to be a great time today. And also remember our Christmas project. I want to explain what this is all about, reaching 100 plus families with children in need to make sure they have a good Christmas. We have 3 tables set up for 3 different type of topics of how we want to bless them. You can go over, you can pick up one of our Heart Smile cards, and they will explain exactly how that works as far as how you're going to bless people. But anyway, so we have 3 tables. In the back table, in the back right here, there are shoes and miscellaneous. Up here at the drum cage, by the drum cage, is clothing, blessing with clothing. And over here on this side is toys, bikes, etc. right over here. So if any of these areas you really feel like you want to bless, or if you want to bless all 3, just go and just visit the tables and they'll explain to you how you can sponsor kids. All right? Go ahead and stand up. Be blessed. Let's have a great, great week.
I lift my head in the battle. Set my eyes on a gold face.
Including live or on-demand video, event registration, online giving, and much more. And don't forget to follow Now Church on our social media platforms, including Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And please use the hashtag NowChurch. Thank you.